This program was made possible by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
Good evening and welcome to this PBS NewsHour special. I'm Judy Woodruff, and we are just moments away from hearing from President Trump, who is set to address the nation tonight from the Oval Office regarding the coronavirus crisis. Earlier today, the World Health Organization officially characterized the COVID-19 outbreak as a global pandemic, citing what it called alarming levels of spread and severity and alarming levels of inaction. The novel coronavirus has now killed roughly 4,400 people worldwide and infected about 120,000, including more than 1,200 here in the U.S. 37 Americans have died from the virus so far. The pandemic label helped to trigger another nosedive on Wall Street today as the Dow Jones Industrial Average entered bear market territory. It has now fallen 20% below last month's record close, and this may be one of the reasons for tonight's speech. With me, watching along with me, are our congressional correspondent, Lisa Desjardins, and our White House correspondent, Yamiche Alcindor. We are, to both of you who've been covering this story, this is something we've been waiting for ever since the World Health Organization made the declaration that it is a pandemic. President Trump.
My fellow Americans, tonight I want to speak with you about our nation's unprecedented response to the coronavirus outbreak that started in China and is now spreading throughout the world. Today, the World Health Organization officially announced that this is a global pandemic. We have been in frequent contact with our allies, and we are marshaling the full power of the federal government and the private sector to protect the American people. This is the most aggressive and comprehensive effort to confront a foreign virus in modern history. I am confident that by counting and continuing to take these tough measures, we will significantly reduce the threat to our citizens, and we will ultimately and expeditiously defeat this virus. From the beginning of time, nations and people have faced unforeseen challenges, including large-scale and very dangerous health threats. This is the way it always was and always will be. It only matters how you respond, and we are responding with great speed and professionalism. Our team is the best anywhere in the world. At the very start of the outbreak, we instituted sweeping travel restrictions on China and put in place the first federally mandated quarantine in over 50 years. We declared a public health emergency and issued the highest level of travel warning on other countries as the virus spread its horrible infection. And taking early, intense action, we have seen dramatically fewer cases of the virus in the United States than are now present in Europe. The European Union failed to take the same precautions and restrict travel from China and other hotspots. As a result, a large number of new clusters in the United States were seeded by travelers from Europe. After consulting with our top government health professionals, I have decided to take several strong but necessary actions to protect the health and well-being of all Americans. To keep new cases from entering our shores, we will be suspending all travel from Europe to the United States for the next 30 days. The new rules will go into effect Friday at midnight. These restrictions will be adjusted subject to conditions on the ground. There will be exemptions for Americans who have undergone appropriate screenings, and these prohibitions will not only apply to the tremendous amount of trade and cargo, but various other things as we get approval. Anything coming from Europe to the United States is what we are discussing. These restrictions will also not apply to the United Kingdom. At the same time, we are monitoring the situation in China and the South Korea. And as their situation improves, we will reevaluate the restrictions and warnings that are currently in place for a possible early opening. Earlier this week, I met with the leaders of the health insurance industry who have agreed to waive all co-payments for coronavirus treatments, extend insurance coverage to these treatments and to prevent surprise medical billing. We are cutting massive amounts of red tape to make antiviral therapies available in record time. These treatments will significantly reduce the impact and reach of the virus. Additionally, last week I signed into law an $8.3 billion funding bill to help CDC and other government agencies fight the virus and support vaccines, treatments, and distribution of medical supplies. Testing and testing capabilities are expanding rapidly day by day. We are moving very quickly. The vast majority of Americans, the risk is very, very low. Young and healthy people can expect to recover fully and quickly if they should get the virus. The highest risk is for elderly population with underlying health conditions. The elderly population must be very, very careful. In particular, we are strongly advising that nursing homes for the elderly suspend all medically unnecessary visits. In general, older Americans should also avoid non-essential travel in crowded areas. My administration is coordinating directly with communities with largest outbreaks, and we have issued guidance on school closures, social distancing, and reducing large gatherings. Smart action today will prevent the spread of the virus tomorrow. Every community faces different risks, and it is critical for you to follow the guidelines of your local officials who are working closely with our federal health experts, and they are the best. For all Americans, it is essential that everyone take extra precautions and practice good hygiene. Each of us has a role to play in defeating this virus. Wash your hands, clean often used surfaces, cover your face and mouth if you sneeze or cough, and most of all, if you are sick or not feeling well, stay home. To ensure that working Americans impacted by the virus can stay home without fear of financial hardship, I will soon be taking emergency action, which is unprecedented, to provide financial relief. This will be targeted for workers who are ill, quarantined, or caring for others due to coronavirus. I will be asking Congress to take legislative action to extend this relief. Because of the economic policies that we have put into place over the last 3 years, we have the greatest economy anywhere in the world by far. Our banks and financial institutions are fully capitalized and incredibly strong. Our unemployment is at a historic low. This vast economic prosperity gives us flexibility, reserves, and resources to handle any threat that comes our way. This is not a financial crisis. This is just a temporary moment of time that we will overcome together as a nation and as a world. However, to provide extra support for American workers, families, and businesses, tonight I am announcing the following additional actions. I am instructing the Small Business Administration to exercise available authority to provide capital and liquidity to firms affected by the coronavirus. Effective immediately, the SBA will begin providing economic loans in affected states and territories. These low-interest loans will help small businesses overcome temporary economic disruptions caused by the virus. To this end, I am asking Congress to increase funding for this program by an additional $50 billion. Using emergency authority, I will be instructing the Treasury Department to defer tax payments without interest or penalties for certain individuals and businesses negatively impacted. This action will provide more than $200 billion of additional liquidity to the economy. Finally, I am calling on Congress to provide Americans with immediate payroll tax relief. Hopefully, they will consider this very strongly. We are at a critical time in the fight against the virus. We made a life-saving move with early action on China. Now we must take the same action with Europe. We will not delay. I will never hesitate to take any necessary steps to protect the lives, health, and safety of the American people. I will always put the well-being of America first. If we are vigilant and we can reduce the chance of infection, which we will significantly impede the transmission of the virus. The virus will not have a chance against us. No nation is more prepared or more resilient than the United States. We have the best economy, the most advanced health care, and the most talented doctors, scientists, and researchers anywhere in the world. We are all in this together. We must put politics aside, stop the partisanship, and unify together as one nation and one family. As history has proven time and time again, Americans always rise to the challenge and overcome adversity. Our future remains brighter than anyone can imagine. Acting with compassion and love, we will heal the sick, care for those in need, help our fellow citizens, and emerge from this challenge stronger and more unified than ever before. God bless you, and God bless America. Thank you.
And that was President Trump speaking from the Oval Office. As you just heard, he's calling for some travel restrictions, especially for those traveling from Europe to the U.S. He's also calling for help to small businesses and to others who may be impacted by the coronavirus. In sum, the president called on the United States, on Americans, to be unified. And he said, this is just a temporary moment in time. We will get through this. That's President Trump. We want to thank you for joining, for joining us for this PBS NewsHour special. We return you now to your regular PBS programming in progress. And for those tuning in for the PBS NewsHour West edition, Lisa Desjardins and Yamiche Alcindor will be back with me with analysis of the president's remarks and the rest of today's news after this brief break.
This program was made possible by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you. Major funding for the PBS NewsHour has been provided by
our economy for 160 years. BNSF, the engine that connects us.
Fidelity Investments. Consumer Cellular. American Cruise Lines.
Supporting social entrepreneurs and their solutions to the world's most pressing problems. SkollFoundation.org.
The Lemelson Foundation, committed to improving lives through invention in the U.S. and developing countries. On the web at lemelson.org. Supported by the John D. and Catherine T. MacArthur Foundation, committed to building a more just, verdant, and peaceful world. More information at macfound.org. And with the ongoing support of these institutions. This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
Welcome back to this special edition of the PBS NewsHour West. President Donald Trump has just concluded his speech, and my colleagues Lisa Desjardins and Yamiche Alcindor are with me for some analysis. So hello to both of you. And Yamiche, we heard from the president both an acknowledgement that this is a global pandemic. It is serious, something that is facing all the American people. But he also, in any call for measures, we heard him speak about restricting travel from Europe. He advised Americans to be careful in hygiene, to wash their hands. But he also was saying this is something we're going to get through. So it was to me it was a combination of a message of seriousness and yet pulling together we can handle this.
That's right. And the president was making the case that he has a plan here, that he has both a plan that he's going to do through executive actions, and also he's saying that he's going to work with Congress to get some legislative action done. But he was also trying to calm people's fears and saying, look, we can handle this. Now, the president, of course, has run into issues where he's been contradicting a lot of health officials, him saying that there was going to be a miracle, that there are going to be cases that were going to go down, where health officials have said, actually, we can guarantee that, unfortunately, more people will likely die, more people will likely get infected. But that said, the president was also laying out specifically what the White House is going to do. And I've been told by White House sources that he's going to be using something called the Stafford Act. And the Stafford Act is a disaster relief act where he's going to have about $42.6 billion to work with to do several things, including give small businesses loans that are affected by the coronavirus, have tax deferrals so people can pay the government later, and also have some sort of relief to people who have missed paychecks because they're impacted by this virus.
And we heard him refer to some of that there at the end of his remarks. Lisa, how will that be received on Capitol Hill?
The payroll tax cut, we already know Democrats are firmly against. They think that for one, now is not the time to talk about that kind of economic stimulus. They're still worried about dealing with the virus itself. But they also believe that that is not going to help the people most affected by the virus. The payroll tax cut, they believe, would help the wealthy more than the people at the bottom end of the payroll. And some Republicans don't like that idea either, because the payroll tax cut would take money that could affect Social Security and Medicare. They're worried about the fiscal bottom lines. That right now is not an easy sell for the president on Capitol Hill. Its fate is unknown. Now, the question of his other request to Congress, $50 billion for small businesses.
Right.
That seems to me something that would be on the table. That is a very large number. I suspect a larger number than members of Congress expected for that one piece of the pie. But I guarantee they will talk about it. Small business is very high on their list of concerns. But now they have another concern, this idea that now we are saying no more flights from Europe for the next 30 days,
something. It's serious.
Very serious. I don't think this has happened in this country since World War II.
No.
That is where we are at. And this is going to heighten the concern and heighten, I think, the pressure on Congress to figure out what to do next. We expect House Democrats to unveil their plan in just a few hours in Congress.
And we'll be looking to see how much cooperation there is, Yamiche, between the two parties, because up until now, there's been very little of it. A very poor relationship between the president and Speaker Pelosi and other leading Democrats. So we'll see. I mean, we heard the president take a shot at Europe. He said the Europeans didn't act quickly enough to shut down travel. And he said, we are going to do that. So is it your sense that the White House is willing to do some work, some negotiating with Democrats?
We know that the White House and Capitol Hill have been negotiating. Vice President Pence, as both Lisa and I have been reporting, has been on the phone with leaders, including Nancy Pelosi. That said, the president said that the partisan politics need to be put aside. But we must remember, of course, that the president has been blaming Democrats and reporters for, he thinks, inflaming the situation around coronavirus, making it more than what it needs to be, when, of course, the numbers have been going up. The other thing to note is, of course, that the president himself sees his political future as tied to the economy. His argument for being reelected is that the economy is doing well. This is a virus that is threatening people's lives and threatening people's livelihoods. I was just talking to people who are very worried that people are going to miss paychecks. People are not going to be able to pay for child care if they have to stay home with their kids. So the president is up against a challenge like nothing he's ever seen.
Yeah. A lot of concerns. Yamiche Alcindor, Lisa Desjardins, we thank you both.
Thanks.
A new wave of cancellations and restrictions on large public gatherings have been announced today in the wake of the coronavirus pandemic. And in an unprecedented move, the NCAA college basketball tournament announced this afternoon that its games will be held without fans in attendance. Amna Nawaz has more on the outbreak's impact both here at home and abroad.
A new global milestone in the spread of the novel coronavirus, COVID-19. The World Health Organization said the crisis has officially reached pandemic proportions.
Pandemic is not a word to use lightly or carelessly. We cannot say this loudly enough, or clearly enough, or often enough. All countries can still change the course of this pandemic.
Here in the U.S., Dr. Anthony Fauci warned lawmakers on Capitol Hill about that course, saying the worst is yet to come.
How much worse we'll get will depend on our ability to do two things: to contain the influx of people who are infected coming from the outside, and the ability to contain and mitigate within our own country. Bottom line, it's going to get worse.
His assessment drew concern from Democrats who accused administration officials of responding too slowly.
This administration was not prepared for this crisis, and it put lives at risk, American lives at risk.
National Security Advisor Robert O'Brien, speaking at the Heritage Foundation today, blamed China for withholding information about the virus, accusing them of hampering the global response.
It probably cost the world community 2 months to respond. And those 2 months, if we'd had those and been able to sequence the virus and had the cooperation necessary from the Chinese, I think we could have dramatically curtailed what happened both in China and what's now happening across the world.
President Trump, during a White House meeting with bank CEOs, defended his administration's actions.
We're having to fix a problem that 4 weeks ago nobody ever thought would be a problem.
Members of Congress, meanwhile, drilled down today on efforts to cushion the economic fallout.
We need an economic vaccine. I'd like to have an economic package to address the damage done by the coronavirus.
Senate Democrats unveiled their proposal today, which included paid sick leave for workers impacted by the coronavirus outbreak.
The help should be aimed at people, not at corporations. We believe the help should be targeted at the people who have suffered from this coronavirus problem.
And House Democrats hope to bring their version up for a vote on the floor tomorrow. At least 39 states in the U.S. and the District of Columbia have so far reported confirmed cases of the coronavirus. Across the country, cities and institutions are grappling with how to contain the spread and protect their communities, from canceling large gatherings to canceling in-person classes on college campuses. Hard-hit countries like South Korea continue with their own efforts. Today, sanitizing subway trains in Seoul. Infections there continue to fall, but a new cluster of cases stemming from a call center has health officials on edge.
As of 7 a.m. today, 90 people were tested positive, and we are investigating how many people were in close contact.
In Italy, where cases today soared beyond 10,000, all stores, aside from pharmacies and supermarkets, closed in response to the crisis. In the Vatican, the Pope's weekly catechism, normally set among tens of thousands in St. Peter's Square, was instead delivered from a private library via video link. In Germany, already facing some 1,300 cases, Chancellor Angela Merkel warned of a wider spread.
The population has no immunity, yet to this virus, there are no vaccines and no therapy so far. That a high percentage, experts say 60 to 70% of the population, will be infected as long as the situation continues.
But in the Chinese city where the virus first emerged, a different picture. Supermarkets and other businesses resumed work, a sign that at least there, the crisis has begun to subside. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Amna Nawaz.
As we reported earlier, the World Health Organization today designated COVID-19 a pandemic, a move that set off alarm bells globally. Earlier this evening, I spoke with Dr. Margaret Harris from the WHO, and I asked her why the agency is now calling COVID-19 a pandemic.
It's really because we're sending a message, and the message we were sending before is get ready. But now the message is, it's here. Get serious. There's still a chance. Many countries have a chance to slow things down, but this virus is going to be in most communities. And so we have to mobilize all our forces, mobilize our people, mobilize our ideas, our innovations to stop it, slow it, so that it does not overwhelm health systems and cause major suffering and death.
When you say in every community, do you mean literally every community, every city, every town, every neighborhood?
It has that potential to do that. So this is why we use a term like pandemic. We were loath to use it because it does instill fear and it does instill panic. Our biggest weapon actually is calm, sensible, rational behavior. an application of our genius. We have seen some incredible technological innovations in Korea and in China, and we've seen them beat down huge epidemics, huge numbers of cases, and bring them down. So we know we can do it, but it really does take every human being on this planet taking it seriously, listening to what needs to be done, and doing it.
That's sobering. And Dr. Harris, when you speak about mobilizing governments, mobilizing people to action, what exactly are you asking governments, health systems to do? And can they do it?
So one of the things that every country, every community needs to do is to understand if someone is infected, we need to find them. So it's not that easy. You need to be tested. And then you also need to identify everyone you've been in contact, and they need to be comfortable and want to be tested and be ready to self-isolate. People also have to be ready not to crowd, not to go into spaces, into situations where they're going to be very close for quite some time, because that is the opportunity for passing on the virus. So that means you make changes. You work from home. You give up very important things like worship. You give up entertainment for a period when you know it's in your community. What we also know is if you do these things, it will pass. You will beat it. But it is a tough thing to do.
So you're putting a lot of responsibility on individuals. At the same time, you're asking governments, healthcare systems, to do their part. What are you looking for them to do? I noticed that the director general of the WHO said that some governments today have had alarming levels of inaction.
So again, governments, we ask to really, really support their health workers and their hospitals and look at their capacity. So it's not simply about the teams who are currently working in intensive care. You need backup. You need to think about how you can provide the next team, because this is going to take a tremendous amount of work. The severe form of this disease leads to respiratory failure, and to survive it, you often need ventilation, and that ventilation can go on for weeks. If you are on that ventilator, the next person who also needs help, where are they going to go? Meanwhile, also, to look after somebody at that level of critical care requires a team of nurses, doctors, other people, ancillary workers, ambulance workers, people working very, very hard for very long periods of time in personal protective equipment. So we are asking an enormous amount of our health workers to get through this. So to stop that, we need to slow the number of cases that develop so that when people do get sick, and there will be people who get very sick, there will be the capacity to look after them.
And for people who are starting to panic, which some are, what is the message?
Well, the message is don't panic, but it's understandable that you have the sense of fear. You know, fear of plague, fear of disease is an innate human fear. You know, we have fear to protect ourselves from the unknown, from something that is a threat, but it also makes you make very bad decisions. So listen to the advice, go to trusted sources. You have some of the world's top brains in science in your country. You've got excellent advice from the CDC, from the NIH, also from the World Health Organization, also from excellent media outlets like PBS. Use those sources, learn, get knowledge up, and help everybody else in your community. Look at the vulnerable and see what you can do for them as well.
Dr. Margaret Harris with the World Health Organization, WHO, thank you very much.
That's a pleasure. Thank you very much for having me on your program.
In today's other news, disgraced movie mogul Harvey Weinstein was sentenced to 23 years in prison. The 67-year-old faced a maximum of 29 years after being convicted of raping a woman in 2013 and sexually assaulting another in 2006. In the New York courtroom today, Weinstein said he was, quote, genuinely confused. Gloria Allred, who represented one of the victims, said the sentence sends a strong message.
If you are a sexual predator and you are confused, all you have to do is remember this. 20 plus 3 years. This is a new day. It's a new day for women to know that if you have courage, there will be consequences for the predators who hurt you.
Weinstein's defense insisted the sentence was too harsh and accused the judge of caving to public pressure.
That number was obnoxious. There are murderers who will get out of court faster than Harvey Weinstein will. That number spoke to the pressure of movements and the public. That number did not speak to the evidence that came out at trial.
Three more sexual assault cases against Weinstein are under investigation in Los Angeles and Beverly Hills, raising the possibility that he could face additional charges. Democratic presidential candidate Bernie Sanders said today that he'll remain in the race for the White House. That is despite suffering a series of losses in yesterday's primary races to former Vice President Joe Biden. Biden now leads the delegate count with 864, compared with Sanders' 710. We'll take a closer look at the state of the race later in the program. The U.S. Supreme Court handed the Trump administration a win on its immigration policy today. It will allow asylum seekers to remain in Mexico until their claims are adjudicated. The move overturned a lower court order that put a partial block on the administration's policy. Some 60,000 people have already been sent back to Mexico to await their U.S. court hearings. The U.S. House of Representatives voted today to extend controversial surveillance tools. The bipartisan bill renews parts of the Foreign Intelligence Surveillance Act, which authorizes monitoring of suspected spies and terrorists. The provisions were set to expire March 15th. The bill now goes to the Senate, where its fate is more uncertain. A rocket attack killed three soldiers, including two Americans, in Iraq today. It happened northwest of Baghdad at a military camp in Taji. U.S. officials say that at least 10 coalition members were injured. There was no immediate claim of responsibility, but the base has been hit before by Iranian-backed militias. In Afghanistan, the Taliban rejected a plan by the Afghan government to stagger the release of prisoners ahead of potential peace talks. An initial deal signed by the U.S. and Taliban last month called for 5,000 Taliban prisoners to be freed. Kabul said that it will let out 1,500 of the prisoners as a goodwill measure and urged the Taliban to halt their fighting.
The process and conditions for the Taliban's prisoner release is very clear in the deal, but the implementation depends on the actions of the Taliban and their visible commitment to reduce violence and to negotiate directly with the Afghan government.
The Afghan government said the remaining prisoners would be released after the negotiations begin, but the Taliban says it wants all prisoners to be freed at once. And the Russian parliament today backed new constitutional reforms to keep President Vladimir Putin in power beyond the year 2024. That would mean that Putin could rule until he is 83 years old. The bill easily passed through both chambers of parliament, but it still must be approved by Russia's constitutional court and a nationwide vote in April.
This is the PBS NewsHour from WETA Studios in Washington and in the West from the Walter Cronkite School of Journalism at Arizona State University.
After Tuesday's Democratic presidential primary contest, former Vice President Joe Biden has a clear lead. He won four states, Idaho, Missouri, Mississippi, and Michigan. Vermont Senator Bernie Sanders won North Dakota. And there's no projected winner yet in Washington state. Our Lisa Desjardins has more.
Today, Bernie Sanders spoke in a smaller, more sober setting than usual. The senator from Vermont said that defeating President Trump was still his number one goal, and he'll keep challenging Joe Biden for the Democratic nomination despite yesterday's primary night letdown.
On Sunday night, in the first one-on-one debate of this campaign, the American people will have the opportunity to see which candidate is best positioned to accomplish that goal.
There's no sugarcoating it. Tonight's a tough night.
Sanders supporter and New York Congresswoman Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez took to Instagram to console supporters and congratulate Biden. In a majority of yesterday's contests, moderate, suburban, and black voters propelled the former vice president to victory over Sanders, leading to this moment last night in Philadelphia, with Biden making this appeal directly to Sanders backers.
I want to thank Bernie Sanders and his supporters for their tireless energy and their passion. We share a common goal, and together, we'll defeat Donald Trump.
One major Biden supporter, longtime South Carolina Congressman Jim Clyburn, told NPR that it might be time soon to wind down the primary fight.
I think we will be at a point where Joe Biden will be the prohibitive nominee of the party, and I think the DNC, the Democratic National Committee, should then step in, make an assessment, and determine whether or not they ought to have any more debates.
Both scrapped planned events last night because of coronavirus concerns, and the planned TV debate on Sunday will go on, but without a live audience. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Lisa Desjardins.
To give us more insight on how the Democratic Party is handling this changing primary race, I'm joined by Democratic National Committee Chair Tom Perez. Tom Perez, welcome back to the
NewsHour.
Always
a pleasure to be with you.
First question, does Bernie Sanders still have a chance to win the Democratic nomination?
Certainly. We're a little under 50% of the delegates have been allocated. The magic number is 1,991. And so primaries are often about, they're always about math, and they're often about momentum. And certainly the vice president has achieved some momentum here in South Carolina, Super Tuesday, and then this week. I've coached enough team sports and been around politics enough to know that momentum shifts do occur. And our job is to make sure that we continue to have a fair process and continue to work so that whoever our nominee is, we can hit the ground running and we will be united as a party. And I'm confident we will.
So how do you respond to Congressman James Clyburn's saying that it's time for the DNC, it's time for this primary process to be shut down?
Well, I think it's always up to the candidates to figure out when it is time to say when. And I respect the judgment of Senator Sanders moving forward. We have four more very important races next Tuesday. Those will provide us with some more information and insight because they're big states, Ohio, Illinois, Arizona, and the biggest prize of all next Tuesday is Florida. So we will be over the 50% mark by the end of the day Tuesday. 2 weeks from Tuesday, or 2 weeks from yesterday, we then go down to Georgia. And so that's basically what we have for the next few weeks. And I think then, again, this is about math. This is about understanding where you are in a process. And I don't think it's my place as the DNC chair to tell somebody when it's time to end your campaign. That's always up to the candidates. I didn't call Pete Buttigieg, or I didn't call Amy Klobuchar, any of the candidates who got out. I never called anyone and said, I think it's really time for you to get out. That was a judgment that they made on their own based on their own analysis.
But it does sound as if other leaders in the party are saying that either out loud or privately.
Well, again, I can't stop others from doing what they're doing. What I can do is make sure that everybody gets a fair shake. And one thing I know, because I've had the good fortune of working with both the vice president and with Senator Sanders, one thing I know is that whoever our nominee is, they are both going to work their tails off to defeat Donald Trump. And we have seen an absolute explosion in turnout. And I credit not only the two of them who are still in the race, I credit all the candidates. The excitement that has been generated throughout this Democratic primary. You look at yesterday, more record turnout. You looked at Super Tuesday, record turnout. In New Hampshire blew through the numbers in 2008. South Carolina, same thing. So the energy is there, the momentum is there, and we will come together as a party.
I'm sure that you heard Senator Sanders' statement today, hit the questions that he said he wants to hear Vice President Biden respond to, having to do with Medicare for all, having to do with college debt, with climate change, suggesting pretty clearly that he expects Joe Biden to accommodate some of Bernie Sanders' positions. How far do you think Joe Biden should go in accommodating some of the more progressive ideas of Bernie Sanders?
Well, I think, again, one of the things that gives me great optimism as we move forward, Judy, is that what unites us as a party far exceeds what our differences are. Everybody running for president understands the imperative of combating climate change and making sure that we make decisions based on the science. Everybody understands that. Everybody running for president understands that we should make sure that everyone has access to quality, affordable health care. And thanks to LBJ and Barack Obama, we're about 85-90% of the way up the mountain of universal health care. They undeniably have differences of opinion on how to get that last 10% to the mountaintop, but the imperative of getting there, they have complete agreement on, and the imperative of making sure that people with pre-existing conditions being able to maintain their coverage, they completely agree on. Taking on the pharmaceutical industry, they completely agree on. So what unites us, I think, far exceeds what our differences are, and the voters will see that.
Two quick questions about coronavirus. Given the severity of what we know is now going on, it's a pandemic, should our two political parties find ways to work together that they haven't found before now on this issue?
Well, I think there are a number of areas where I would hope that we could have worked together. You know, one letter we sent a long time ago was if either party obtains information that was a product of foreign interference, we should never use that information. We sent a letter a while ago calling on the Republicans to come together on that. Unfortunately, they said no. I would love to figure out ways to work together. We should be following our public health guidance, our public health professionals. I have great respect for the doctors and other professionals at the National Institutes of Health. I had the privilege of working with many of them in the Obama administration. And I think we should be able to come together. This is, coronavirus is not about, you know, right versus left. It's about public health, and it's about making sure that we as a nation can come together. It's very disappointing to see the absence of sufficient preparedness. I saw how preparedness worked with Ebola. You may recall, and your viewers will recall, when President Obama took office, H1N1 very real, and that preparedness helped. Those shouldn't be partisan issues. We should be able to come together around principles of preparedness.
Very quickly, plans still on for the Democratic National Convention in July.
Yes, they are, and we're going to continue to work with federal, state, and local officials to make sure that we put no one in harm's way so that we can have a good convention.
Tom Perez, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Now, take a moment to hear from your local PBS station. It's a chance to offer your support, which helps to keep programs like ours on the air. Now, we turn to the story of a charter school in Baltimore that is exceeding graduation rates and is drawing attention. Special correspondent Hari Srinivasan has this encore report.
Thank you for giving us this day actually to watch over Jordan, Amanda, and cover.
Every day begins with a prayer in the home of Nicole McClinton Wilkes and her two children, Amanda and Jordan Westbrook.
Amanda, I'm going to get you egg.
McClinton Wilkes, a single mom who works as a security guard and has to leave early for work, worries about Amanda's safety on her morning commute through the surrounding neighborhoods. But she's relieved when Amanda arrives at her destination, an educational oasis in the heart of West Baltimore. Amanda, who is 17, is a senior at the Green Street Academy, a 6th through 12th grade charter school started in 2010 that currently has about 850 students.
What's the job of a scientist?
Yes. In many ways, it's a typical school with courses like science and Spanish.
Esto, repeat after me, phenomenal.
But there's a lot about Green Street that's not typical for an urban school. Students here are exposed to a wide range of opportunities to explore and learn outside of the classroom. On a recent afternoon, Amanda and her classmates tended to a flock of well-loved chickens on the 8-acre farm behind the school.
We used the chicken eggs and would sell it to different places like school stores and restaurants around the neighborhood to like work with these animals and stuff to actually get the hands-on experience. It just makes me happy.
4 years ago, the school moved to its current location, a renovated historic building that was once a junior high before being abandoned about 30 years ago. There's a lottery to get in. Last year, more than 1,000 applied for 250 openings. According to the school, 90% of graduating seniors in the spring were accepted to 2- and 4-year college programs. In a greenhouse, students learn to grow produce and incorporate it into meals they make at pop-up restaurants.
If we're gonna have two people that wanna catch fish.
Tanks full of tilapia and perch in the school's basement provide hands-on exposure to aquaculture, one of the country's fastest growing food production industries.
It's to just make the overall shape that you see here, and which is...
All that training and other career-focused courses like construction management and nursing are part of the school's primary goal, to give students the skills and experiences they need to be successful after high school, ready for both college and careers.
I think adults sometimes kind of limit kids' options by telling them that it has to be one way or the other, when at our school it's not like that at all.
Crystal Harden-Lindsay is the executive director of the school. Every morning, she and other senior staff visit classrooms to check on students. 97% of Green Street students qualify for free or reduced lunches. Students who need extra support get regular counseling and tutoring. Harden-Lindsay says one of the school's top priorities, getting students into high-quality paid internships, has been a big boost to students and their families.
What we do at Green Street is we provide a way for them to make money while going to school, kind of restructure the trajectory of their lives by saying you can make money, you can also give back to your community, and you can also go to college. It doesn't have to be you choose one or the other. It can be a combination of things.
That dual emphasis on college and careers is reinforced throughout students' time at Green Street.
That homework assignment was...
By ninth grade, students are required to have resumes, and they're encouraged to consider careers they may not have.
I want us to take a deeper look into STEM fields and STEM jobs.
College logos line the school's hallways, and seniors have to apply to at least one community college or university. Several counselors stay on top of their plans.
I would like you to do a little bit more research and pick one more Maryland college.
On a recent afternoon, the school seniors gathered for a class meeting about the year ahead.
I need our Green Street kids to go in there and wow people.
Tyshawn Kelly is the director of internships and student enrichment at Green Street. She was promoting an internship through an organization called Urban Alliance, which provides intensive workplace training. Students are then placed in paid internships with Baltimore businesses, including Bank of America and Johns Hopkins. A few land permanent jobs after they graduate.
And I'm going to specifically speak to those of you who know you're not going to college. If you need a full-time job when you graduate, this is your shot.
For the past 3 years, Kelly has been building the school's internship program, and now close to 60% of the high school students participate. But she says it's not always easy.
I feel like some of our kids have stopped dreaming. Like when you ask them what they want to be, it's very flat line because they don't believe it can happen for them. It happens for everybody else. So letting them see, hey, this is your peer. They did Johns Hopkins last year. They loved it. They're going to do it again this year. You try it. Or, you know, try the law program. We have law links, you know, just keeping them exposed.
Amanda Westbrook has participated in several internships, including one with Kaiser Permanente, where her payment was a $1,000 college scholarship. That will come in handy next year. She's currently applying to colleges and hopes to be a marine biologist one day.
Try that piece right there.
Amanda's big brother, Jordan, who graduated from Green Street last spring, decided to go the career route. He's now in a paid construction training program, earning certifications.
I knew I didn't really want to go to college, so I just knew that once I graduated, I really wanted to get a job. I'm pretty good with my hands, so I'm gonna do construction.
Hey, good morning.
Mom Nicole McClinton Wilkes says Green Street has given her children opportunities that match their interests.
Amanda wants school, Jordan doesn't want school. Jordan, this is what he wants, not my dreams, but his dreams. And that's what I like. They don't sell a fake dream here. They give you reality.
For most Green Street graduates, the reality is school and work go hand in hand.
The pancreas is right here. This
recent grad
right
Michaela
here.
Wilson Weebly is at Coppin State University, just 10 minutes away from Green Street. While studying to eventually become an OBGYN, she's also working part-time. She says Green Street prepared her to juggle both.
I was prepared based on like time management, because that's one thing they always stress. Time management, don't procrastinate, get it done on time.
Back at Green Street Academy, students are harvesting apples and enjoying the fruits of their labor. And in the coming months, the school will begin a capital campaign for a new innovation center focused on living wage career training for both students and their parents. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Hari Srinivasan in Baltimore, Maryland.
And a dramatic sign of the times tonight. The NBA has announced that it is suspending all further games this season after a player with the Utah Jazz tested positive tonight for COVID-19. In addition, President Trump has canceled planned trips this week to Nevada and Colorado. And the publicist for actor Tom Hanks confirms that he and his wife, Rita Wilson, have both tested positive for the coronavirus while staying in Australia. We're going to let you hear now just a portion of what President Trump had to say a little bit earlier tonight in his address to the American people.
To keep new cases from entering our shores, we will be suspending all travel from Europe to the United States for the next 30 days. The new rules will go into effect Friday at midnight. These restrictions will be adjusted subject to conditions on the ground. There will be exemptions for Americans who have undergone appropriate screenings, and these prohibitions will not only apply to the tremendous amount of trade and cargo, but various other things as we get approval. Anything coming from Europe to the United States is what we are discussing. These restrictions will also not apply to the United Kingdom. At the same time, we are monitoring the situation in China and the South Korea. And as their situation improves, we will reevaluate the restrictions and warnings that are currently in place for a possible early opening.
That was President Trump speaking within the hour to the American people. I'm here with my colleague Lisa Desjardins, who covers the Congress for us. Lisa, so much to talk about. This coronavirus story moving very fast.
Yes.
We reported that the NBA National Basketball Association suspending the season. You were telling me it lasts about another month or so. And this after a player came down with coronavirus. In addition, we have the news about Tom Hanks and Rita Wilson, but in a more serious, it's all serious, but tonight in that speech, we heard the president talk about travel restrictions. He also spoke about the efforts he wants to make money available to people, to businesses who may be hurting.
His first focus is small businesses in this country, but tonight the announcement is from a very large business, the NBA. That's an $8 billion a year business. The NBA season was scheduled to end April 15th. It has now been suspended indefinitely, as you said. This is after a player from the Utah Jazz tested positive for COVID-19. That team has recently traveled to, just in the last week, Toronto, Detroit, Boston, all for games. That's not a risk for fans in the stadium, but it is a risk for anyone who had contact with that player, which includes all of those teams. The game tonight that the Utah Jazz was going to play was suspended before it began because of this information. I see reporting now that those players are now being quarantined. This is all happening right now. I think where we're at, Judy, is an incredible pivot point in significance in the history of this virus and perhaps in this country right now as we're seeing kind of the news really just grow.
Well, and in the history of the country, Lisa, because when you realize that all travel, with some exceptions from Europe into the United States, is now halted.
That's right.
And the president made it clear that there will be some exceptions granted, but to make that sweeping an announcement. And then he was talking about $50 billion is what he's asking for in emergency authorization to help the businesses that you were just talking about. It's a lot of money.
27 countries in the European Union, first of all, that is a huge amount of the travel business. But you're right, $50 billion is a large amount of money. I do not believe Congress was ready for that large of a request in that area right now. But they will likely consider it because they are concerned about small businesses as well. I just am talking to Chuck Schumer's office, the Democratic leader of the Senate. They are saying that he spoke to the vice president and Anthony Fauci earlier this evening, and that they are still concerned about something the president did not mention, which is the availability of testing kits, and that we still have not seen those as widely available as it seems the health
profession wants them.
It's interesting the president did not bring that up tonight. At least I didn't hear him bring that up because there's been a controversy. The president at one point said there were plenty available. If anyone wants one, it's there to be used. But of course, we come to find out there are many, many more. There are millions more that they are trying to produce them. They're trying to make them available. But at this point, they aren't available.
Nor did he mention that he was restricting his own travel. He had an address to the nation, and that announcement was made after he finished. So he's trying to instill confidence. He's telling people to be calm. But he didn't say anything about his own preparations, his own decisions.
No question. This development that now we know the coronavirus global pandemic having sweeping effects on the lives of ordinary people, on the people who make decisions for all of us. It is a story that is consuming all of us in the news industry and consuming ordinary Americans. Lisa Desjardins, thank you very much for being with us tonight. And that is the NewsHour for this night. I'm Judy Woodruff. For all of us at the PBS NewsHour, thank you, and we will see you soon.
Major funding for the PBS NewsHour has been provided by...
Before we talk about your investments, what's new?
Audrey's expecting.
Twins.
We'd be closer to the twins.
Change in plans.
At Fidelity, a change in plans is always part of the plan.
When it comes to wireless, Consumer Cellular gives its customers the choice. Our no-contract plans give you as much or as little talk, text, and data as you want. And our U.S.-based customer service team is on hand to help. To learn more, go to consumercellular.tv.
American Cruise Lines. BNSF Railway. The Ford Foundation, working with visionaries on the front lines of social change worldwide. And with the ongoing support of these individuals and institutions. This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
You're watching PBS.